Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. My name is Peter Langen. I work at Bloomberg News, and I'll be your MC for today. MC for today is a fairly easy job because our speaker needs no introduction. He was Prime Minister of Japan from 1994 to 1996. During this time, he made the landmark statement on the 50th commemoration of the end of World War II in the Pacific. That is the issue he'll be talking about today. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Tomiichi Murayama.
Hello, I've just been introduced. My name is Tomiichi Murayama.
私は外国語っていうのはもう英語はもとより全然ダメですから、もう日本語以外はダメなんです。ですから何を話をしていいのか、何を話をしているのか、僕にはさっぱりわからないわけです。ですから今日はこういう場に来てですね、もう率直な話をねしていたさせていただいて、そして皆さんの質問があれば質問に答えてですね、お答えできることはお答えするということにしてほしいというふうに思います。
So I must apologize for not being able to be adept at any foreign languages, including English. I have really no idea what people are saying in this room unless they speak Japanese, because Japanese is the only language I feel comfortable in. So I really did not know how to prepare for today's press conference. I didn't know what I should say. I thought the best approach to take would be to just be very honest and very frank and to try to respond to your questions later and try to respond as honestly as I can.
おそらく私が20年前に総理大臣をやっている時ですね、村山談話というのを出しました。で、今70年になってですね、安倍さんが改めて安倍談話を出したいと、こういう話になっておりますからね。ですから村山談話と安倍談話とどういうふうに違うんだろうか、何を言いたいんだろうかというようなことで、世界的な注目を集めておると、こういう今状況になるんだと思います。
So, as was explained a few moments ago, 20 years ago, when I was serving as Prime Minister, I issued a statement on the anniversary of the war, and it was called the Murayama Statement. Now we're approaching the 70th anniversary of the end of the war, and Prime Minister Abe is saying that he wants to issue his own statement, the Abe Statement. And I think the world is focusing on this statement, and they are asking what will be different between the Murayama Statement and the Abe Statement. What does he want to say?
村山談話というのは、20年前にですね、ちょうど戦後50年の節目なんですよ。で、戦後50年の節目にですね、内政問題やら外交問題やらね、とりわけ日本はアジアの一員ですからね、アジアの国々からもっと信頼される国になる必要があると。そのためにはね、やっぱり過去の歴史に対する認識というものをね、きちっと示して、そして悪かったことは悪かったと、お詫びすることをお詫びすると、そしてこういう過ちを二度と繰り返してはならんという思いをですね、明確にして、そしてこれから進む日本の方針というものをね、出していくと、皆さんが理解をいただくと。ということでなければ、日本は信頼されない、アジアで孤立した国になってしまうと、これではいけないんではないかと、言うんで、20年の戦後50年の節目にですね、締めくくりをする意味で、談話を出すということに決めたわけです。
So 20 years ago, I did issue this Murayama statement, and the reason for that was, as it was explained, it was the 50th anniversary of the end of the war, and 50, of course, is a half century. It's a very, very special milestone year, and at that time, we were facing both in terms of domestic politics, in terms of diplomacy, diplomatic efforts with other nations. There was a turning point. It was an important time for Japan. It was a time when Japan was realizing, becoming aware again that it was a member of the Asian community, the Asian nations community, and it became aware of the fact that it needed to be more trusted by the other countries of Asia. And as a result of this, it was thought that we should put an end to this lingering history that we had had as a result of the World War. In other words, it was time to take a step back and say what we did, the things that we did that were wrong or bad, we should just admit that they were wrong and bad. And if there are areas where we should apologize for, we should apologize. And we should also vow never to repeat the errors or mistakes of the past. We should be very, very clear about the direction that Japan wanted to take in the future, which was to walk towards the future together with the countries of Asia as a member of the Asian community. We wanted to do this, otherwise we would felt that Japan would be isolated within the Asian community. Japan would be completely isolated and alone. So this was the 50th year, and this is the reason for the Murayama statement. We wanted to bring things to a close and start afresh.
Murayama Dangawa, 総理個人のですね、 歴史観が貴重になることはそれは当然ですけどもね。しかし村山談話、村山総理個人の談話ではなくて閣議で決めて政府の談話として出されたわけです。
Certainly, when we talk about the Murayama statement, because it does have my name, it's obviously a statement that was issued while I was Prime Minister. It does certainly reflect the thoughts of myself as an individual, as Prime Minister, but it is more than that. It is not simply a statement that I issued as an individual. It was a statement that was approved by the Cabinet and was issued officially by the government.
その自民党自体は、まあ大多数が村山談話には反対という意見が大変強い。ですから政府もやっぱりその力に左右されてですね、村山談話というものをあまり評価してない。だから当時宣伝もしてないです。
But at the same time, this is the time when the LDP still retained great numbers and had a great majority, and as a result, had great numbers in the government, in the National Diet, and as a result, the majority of LDP members were very much against the contents of the Murayama statement. Some of them felt very, very strongly about the Murayama statement. As a result, the government, reflecting this strong feelings within the LDP, basically did not overly highly push the Murayama statement. It didn't advertise it or promote it in a very large way.
ですから、国民の皆さんもね、村山談話っていうのは何なのかということを全然知らないんですよ。私自身ももう忘れてました。So
the reality is
20年前の話ですからね。
So the reality is that many people in Japan themselves did not even know about the Murayama statement, and I myself had almost forgotten about it. After all, it was something that happened 20 years ago.
日本の国内はそういう状況でしたけどもね、談話が出てからですね、それは韓国、中国をはじめですね、ASEANの国はもとより、それはアメリカだってそうだってそうですしね、ヨーロッパの国々だって大変評価されてましたよね。例えば、ドイツのね、当時首相だった、プラントという首相がですね、ポーランドに行って、慰霊碑の前でひざまずいてですね、謝罪をしたと。 ね、あれで相当まあドイツ国民のね、戦争に対する反省の意思を表明しているということでね、評価されているわけです。あの姿と今度の村山談話をひっ付けするものだと、もうこれで歴史問題の決着がついたと、これからは新しい時代を作っていこうと、こう言ってですね、もう大変評価されて歓迎されたんです。
So although the Japanese government may not have evaluated the Murayama statement very highly, and the situation in Japan was that most people didn't really pay much attention to it, abroad the story was a very, very different. It was a very, very different story abroad. After the Murayama statement was issued, South Korea, the Republic of Korea, China, and other Asian nations, also the United States, European nations, evaluated, regarded this statement very, very highly. For example, in Germany, I'm sure you're all very aware of the fact that a former chancellor Chancellor, Mr. Willy Brandt, visited a monument in a war monument in Poland and got on his knees to express his apologies. This had a tremendous psychological effect on the people of not only the world but also the people of Germany. They felt remorse and they felt that the after effects of the war had been brought to a close. Many people regarded the Murayama statement to be on the same level as that apology by Mr. Brandt, and many people said, therefore, that the historical war issues, problems, had also been ended in Asia, and that we were all entering a new, hopeful age.
So you know, まあ諸外国ではね、大変評価されてるんだけども、日本国内ではむしろ逆ですね。なんでどこの国もやってたことをね、日本はやっただけではないかと。かつてヨーロッパの国は全部アジアに対してね、侵略をして植民地支配をしているではないかと、ね、むしろそういうヨーロッパの勢力に対してね、アジアを守るために植民地解放の戦争をしたんだと。何が悪いかと、なぜ誤る主張があるのかと、お前は米国だぞと、こう言って国民から逆に私は当時その罵倒されるような批判を浴びていくことはあります。
So this was how other nations regarded the Murayama statement. However, the way that it was regarded in Japan was quite different, almost the reverse. There were many people in Japan who felt very, very strongly that Japan was being singled out for blame when Japan was simply doing what other nations had been doing at that time. Specifically, this was a time of colonization where the great powers, European nations, were coming to the countries of Asia and basically invading them and making colonies of them. And Japan was simply trying to stop that trend. In other words, it was trying to free the colonies. Why, therefore, did Japan have to be accused of doing something bad? And by apologizing, in a sense, I was being regarded as a traitor. In fact, I remember being at that time called that publicly.
ですから、国内ではあまり評価されてないんだけども、その外国の環境はそうですからね。私の後を引き継いだ後継内閣はですね、もうすべて自民党から民主党からすべてですね、総理になった大臣になった人はみんな村山談話を継承するということを鮮明にしてきたわけです。
So again, domestically, this was the situation. But again, abroad, the Murayama statement was regarded very, very highly. That is why all successive governments, administrations following, whether they are of the LDP or of the DPJ-led administrations, all of successive governments, all successive prime ministers have said they will continue with or continue to uphold, the Japanese word is keisho suru, the Murayama statement.
ですから、そういうその責任問題、その戦争責任に対するですね、その責任問題というのはね、一応もう解消されたような形になってるんですね。それで村山談話というのはもう全然国内では問題にされなくて、評価もされなくて、誰も知らなかったということになってるんですよ。それが再現してきたのはどういう意味かと、なぜかと言いますとね、それは安倍さんも第一次安倍内閣の時には継承すると言ってきたんだけども、第二次安倍内閣の時ですね、継承すると言ったけども全て継承するわけではないと、ね、侵略という言葉には国際的定義はないというようなことをいろいろ言うてですね、疑問を呈しているわけです。その挙句に70年談話を出したいと、こういうものですからね、なぜ70年談話を出す必要があるのかと。ね、むしろ出すんならね、やっぱりその歴史問題を踏襲した形でね、きちっとやっぱり出すべきだという意見もあるし、安倍さんはそうではなくて、できればそういう問題については触れたくないという気持ちもあるのかもしれませんね。まあ、それで話題を提供して、今問題になってるわけです。
So again, in regard to the Murayama statement, that was a clean break with the past. It made very clear where the responsibility for the war lay. As a result, all of the historical lingering problems or issues of the war were supposed to have been resolved as a result of the Murayama statement. As a result, over time, the Murayama statement came to be forgotten, and really, no one really knew about it. No one had really thought about it. And suddenly, however, now it is the focus of great attention. And why is this? is so, it is because of what Prime Minister Abe has been doing. In his first cabinet, he said very publicly and very clearly that he intended to follow in the spirit of the Murayama statement. In other words, he would uphold, again, the Japanese word is keisho, succeed or inherit the Murayama statement. But in the second cabinet, he has changed his comments slightly. He says that he will uphold it, but not necessarily in its entirety. In other words, he has also added such comments as the word, and the Japanese word is shinryaku, which can be translated as aggression or evasion. He says that the word shinryaku, there is no internationally agreed upon definition as to what it constitutes, a shinryaku or aggression. There is no internationally accepted definition. In other words, these kinds of comments, he has also said that he wants to issue another, his own statement. So all of these comments have started to raise some kind of concerns and doubts and suspicions. Some people ask, why is it necessary to issue another statement at this time? And if he does do so, then he should be very careful and follow in the steps of his predecessors. However, probably Mr. Abe has slightly different ideas.
Abe-san が、そういう発言をしてですね、 一体どういう談話を出すのかということで注目をされ、関心を持たれている。で、若い人たちが村山談話とは一体何なのかということを問いなおしていると。で、私のところにそういう質問をしてくる学生もおります。若い人もおります。ですから、戦争を知らなかった、戦後教育をされなかった、そういう皆さんがですね、こういう話題が提供されることによって、一体戦争は何だったのかと。 ね、なぜこれはこんなに問題になっているのかというようなことをですね、学習する意味ではね、歴史を知るという意味からすると、安倍さんは反面教師でいいことをしてくれていると、私は思うんです。
So because of these comments by Mr. Abe, people are beginning to focus on this Murayama statement, and they are starting to show interest in it when they had not done so before. In fact, many young people who really knew nothing about this Murayama statement are beginning to try to investigate it and try to learn more about it. In fact, I directly receive questions from young people, even students, asking what the statement actually was. These are people who were born and educated after the war. They don't know war, and they have not been educated about the details of the war. The fact that Mr. Abe's statements have prompted them to start investigating and trying to learn and study on their own about history, I think is a good thing. In a sense, he has been given, he is what we call a hammen kyoshi, which we literally setting a bad example, which is actually a very good way to give a lesson. So I think what he's done in that sense, prompting people to study history, is a good thing.
そうした安倍さんの発言と関連をしてですね、 今国会で議論されております安全保障関連重法案というのがね審議されておりますけどもねこれは初めてのことですけどねそれは圧倒的多数の憲法学者がね今出されて審議されている安保関連重法案はね憲法に反するとこういう結論を出してですねいろいろな発言をされているわけです。で、どこが反するかと言いますとね、どこの国も個別自衛権と集団的自衛権があると。で、日本の国は憲法が個別自衛権は認めるけれども、集団的自衛権は認めてないと。だから、できないんだと。これに反すると、こう言って今学者は言ってるわけです。ですから、今まで例えば朝鮮戦争がありましたね、湾岸戦争があった、ベトナム戦争があった、 イラク戦争があった、いろいろ戦争があったけれども、日本は憲法があるから戦争には参加できないんです、というんで、後方支援だけをやってるという形でもって収まってきてるわけです。これが日本の憲法の姿だし、これまでのあり方なんです。それを安倍さん自身が憲法解釈を変えてですね、変えて集団的自衛権もこの範囲ならやっていいんだと、これは憲法が認めてると。 言うてですね、こうやろうとしてるわけです。それに対する国民のやっぱり反撃が起こってですね、今皆さんもご案内のように国会の周辺にはね、婦人団体やら若い人たちがね、もう詰めかけて反対だ反対だとこう言って運動やってますね。そういう現象が起きてるわけです。
So in regard to Prime Minister Abe's comments about his issuing a new statement, there are other things that he is proceeding with, and that is pushing forward with the security legislation bills in the Diet. As you know, this is an unprecedented situation that we are facing in that the bills that he is trying to have passed in the Diet, the majority of constitutional experts are saying that they are in violation of the Constitution. This is, as I said, an unprecedented situation. What specifically are the academics pointing to? They are pointing to the fact that, I think many of you are aware of this, that all nations inherently are considered to have the right to not only individual self-defense, but also collective self-defense, collective defense. However, Japan, because of its unique constitution, is, of course, allowed to defend itself as an individual nation, individual self-defense, but it cannot take part in what is called collective defense. And therefore, academics are saying that many of the things that Prime Minister Abe is trying to promote simply are not permitted under the Constitution. In the past, there have been many wars after World War II, the Korean War, Vietnam War, Iraq War, many other wars, but because Japan was restricted by its very singular constitution, has not been able to take part in actual fighting in the battlefront. They've only been able to provide, at best, logistical support. This is the state of the Japanese constitution. This is the state of Japan up to the present day. However, Prime Minister Abe, as you know, has tried to change the interpretation, has gone forward with changing the interpretation of the Constitution. He is saying that now that we have a new interpretation, what we are trying to do in terms of collective defense is allowable within the limits of the Constitution. However, although he presents these arguments, many, many Japanese people have not been accepting of those arguments. And as you can see, as a result, very close by, we have the Diet, and we have many organizations full of women and young people who are demonstrating each day.
だからまあ、一部の声としてはね、その勝手に内閣総理大臣が内閣の方針として憲法解釈を変えて、そしてできないことをやろうとしておる、ね、これは許されないと。だからどうしてもやるというなら憲法を改正してやればいいではないかと、こう言ってまあいう声もあるわけですね。だけども憲法を改正するためにはね、一般の法律と違いましてね、簡単にはできないわけです、ね、これはやっぱり立憲主義を尊重するという意味でね、そんなことは許されないと。で、憲法を改正しようとすれば衆議院参議院で3分の2の議決を経なければね、発議ができないんです。これは国会で決めて、国会が発議をして、そして国民の投票に付して、そして過半数を取ったら改正が成立するということになるんですけども、まあ、現状から考えた場合ね、3分の2の衆参で議決を取るというのはもう不可能です、困難ですよね。ですからそれはできないんですよ。できないからもうしょうがない、解釈を変えてですね、やろうというようなことをやってるもんですから、国民の皆さんがね、いくらなんでもね、総理大臣だからといってね、勝手に憲法解釈を変えてね、やるなんてことは許されないとね、言うて今こう反撃が起こっているわけですけど、これが今の現状なんです。
So there are some people that say that even if it is the Prime Minister of Japan, even if it is the decision of the cabinet, simply to change the interpretation of the Constitution and try to do things that are fundamentally not allowed by the Constitution, this kind of action simply cannot be permitted. If you really truly want to change the way things are and what is permitted under the Constitution, then you must actually revise the Constitution. This is what some people say, but I'm sure many of you are aware of the fact that revising the Constitution in Japan is a very, very difficult, almost an impossible process. That is because there are certain rules in place that place great priority on constitutionalism. In other words, the procedures to revise the Constitution require a two-thirds majority in both the upper house and the lower house to even make a motion for the revising of the Constitution, and then that decision has to be put to the people of Japan. There has to be a national referendum, and a majority have to approve of it before the Constitution can be revised. These kinds of hurdles, a two-thirds majority in support in the upper house and lower house, is almost impossible to conceive of. And that is why, knowing that these difficulties, the hurdles are so high, Prime Minister Abe chose a different route, which was to try to change the interpretation of the Constitution. However, people have again come to the conclusion that even if it is the Prime Minister, a very important person, for him to, on his own, simply change the interpretation, that is simply not allowable.
まあ、今の日本の、この取り巻く現状ですね、まあ、私なりに、まあ、簡単にこうご説明したわけですけども、 私自身はね、今の現状に対してね、それはやっぱり国民の怒りは当然だと、ね、日本はもうこれまで70年間ね、戦争をせずに平和のために生きてきたと、ね、で仮に言われるように北朝鮮が核を持っておると、ね、中国がどんどん拡大して、そして南沙諸島で問題を起こしているし、ね、ベトナムやらフィリピンなんかは非常に脅威に感じている。南シナ海はやっぱり不穏な状態がある。いつ何が起こるか分からないと、こういうことを言われているんですけどもね、そういう危機をね醸し出してね、お互いにこう備え合うということをすればですね、これはやがて戦争につながっていくんでね、過去の歴史はそうですよ。そんなことはね防がないかんですね。そのためにはやっぱり日本は平和憲法を持ってるんだからね、戦争はしないんだと、話し合いで解決しようと言って外交問題を持って解決していくと、そしてそういう問題を未然に防いでいくということの方が大事ではないかと、ね、だから平和憲法というものは大事なんだと、これまで70年間ねもう世界が認めてきてるんだと、でこの平和憲法をしっかり守ってですね、そういう役割こそ日本はこれから果たすべきではないかと、それがあれだけの戦争をやってきたね償いだというような気持ちで、私はこれからもやっていく必要があるのではないかと、まあ、いうふうに思ってますけどね、端的に言いますとね。
So I've described the recent situation in Japan according to my understanding. I've given you a very simple explanation of the current situation. In regard to the current reality that Japan faces, I think that it is only natural that the Japanese people have grown angry over the current situation. After all, I keep repeating that Japan has experienced peace for over 70 years. And that is simple to say, but it is actually an extraordinary thing. I understand that different scenarios are presented, that North Korea, after all, is a nearby country and it possesses nuclear weapons. China is increasing its power and influence. It is causing troubles, slight conflicts with other nations in around, for example, the Spratly Islands, with the Philippines, Vietnam. And there is a situation, heightened tensions within the South China Seas. People don't know what might actually happen. We are facing, people say, an almost crisis situation, and we have to be prepared. But bringing these kinds of arguments to the forefront and is a way of provoking the other side to feel anxiety as well. This is the lesson that we've always learned from history. This is not the way that we should proceed. What politicians, leaders, countries must do is to prevent these heightened tensions from rising even further or exploding into war. That is why Japan has clung so forcefully to its peaceful constitution. Japan believes very strongly that it is only through dialogue, through communication, that you prevent in advance the eruption of hostilities. That is why, again, this 70 years of peace, this peace constitution, pacifist constitution that Japan has held for so long is of such great importance. Even the world has recognized its significance. We have clung to this peaceful constitution, pacifist constitution, in part because we want to atone for our past.
最初のお話がね、あんまり喋らんで、ね、挨拶は簡単にして、できるだけ質問に答えてほしいと、こういう注文がございましたので、もう私の話は以上で一遍締め切ってですね、皆さん方のご質問にお答えしたいと。
So I was told before I came into the room that I should try to limit my opening remarks to as short as comments as possible, so to leave room for questions and answers. So I would like to end my speech here. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Mr. Murayama. I'll open the floor to questions now. For those of you who are unfamiliar, the first questions go to the working press. So if we have time, we'll open the floor to all. So working press only first. This gentleman was first up.
はじめは記者の方たちから質問をお受けしたいと思います。もし時間が余りましたら、他の方たちからも質問をお受けします。
Can you please state your name and affiliation, please?
Okay. My name is Richard Sula. I'm from Indonesia. インドネシアの新聞記者なんですけれども、特派員、リチャード・スシロでございます。ちょっと簡単な質問なんですけれども、 この間1週間2週間前ぐらいかな、村山元総理を、まあ、あの国会で、道のところに、まあ、あの反対運動であの参加しましたので、そこが私はあの本当に、心から分かりませんので、Tomiichi Murayamaさんがもともとを総理大臣なんですけれども、これは国の中でトップ1位ですね、ナンバーワンですね。なぜそこまでやるしかない、ちょっとあの分かりませんので、必要ありますでしょうか、参加するの道まで、そういうあのことをちょっとずっと考えているので、ちょっとあの答えをあの欲しいですけども、よろしくお願いします。
Okay. So, a simple question. A week ago, I saw you in front of the Diet with opposition group, not opposition groups, but just demonstrators. And I really could not understand why you, who served as Prime Minister at the number one position in the nation, had to resort to being out in the streets with other demonstrators. Was it truly such a necessary thing? あの、この前、国会の前で、あの一般のデモの方たちと一緒に参加して、うん、あの反対を表明されてたんですが、国のトップを務めた方がそこまでしなくては本当にいけなかったんでしょうか。非常にびっくりした光景だったんでございますが本当に必要だったんでしょうかということです。
あのこのままその全然抵抗がなかったらね、それは国会はもう多数でもって決まってですね、スムーズにいきますよね。そうするとやがてそれは憲法の改正の道につながっていきますしね、それは何かあった場合には日本はやっぱり自衛隊がその戦争に参加してですね、いくようなことになりかねないと、これは危ないと言って、まあ危機感を感じてですね、立ち上がってるわけです。でできるだけやっぱり国民の声を国政に反映してですね、そしてできればその強行採決の中で戦でですね、国会の中で十分議論を尽くしてね、やってほしいという期待と気持ちがあってですね、立ち上がってるわけです。私はね、これはあのいい機会だと思うんですよ。まあ日本の 国っていうのは昔からそうですけどもね、やっぱりその長いものに巻かれろ、ね、強いものには従えと、こういうその風習がずっとあるもんですからね、そのなかなか住民の国民の声がね、素直に国政に反映されないと、ね、で選挙もやっぱりそういう形でもって投与するもんですからね。ですからあの日本の政治というものはなかなか変わらない、ね、もう何遍選挙やってもやっぱり自民党が圧倒的多数を握ってですね、政権を維持していると、こういう状況になってきてですね、今度初めてある意味では国民が自主的に立ち上がって、これでいいのかと、日本国はどうなっていくのかという危機感を感じてですね、今運動しているわけですね。だから国会の中だけでは任されないと、もうこの際やっぱり国民が大きな声を反映してですね、主人公である国民の声で政治を動かすと、こういう状況を作っていく必要があるという自覚を持ってですね、今の若い人たちは立ち上がっている、私はそういうふうに受け止めますね。だからこれはね、日本を変えていく非常に大きな力になっていくというのを思いますからね、私はやっぱり災い手にて福となすというようなことでですね、これをもって日本が本当に民主主義の国になるんだと、国民が主体になって、ね、民主的な国になっていくんだというようなことになっていけばね、これ非常にやっぱりいいことだと思うんです、いい機会だと思うんです、まあ、そういうふうに私はね思ってますから、まあ、この際ねもうあと何年生きるか知らないけども、まあ、生きる限りにおいてはね、やっぱりそういう国民の声を大事にして政治をやれということをやっぱり同調して声を大事にして叫ぶ必要があるんじゃないかと、こういう気持ちで私はあの参加して、街頭で演説したいというわけです。
I think that in politics, for example, in the Japanese Diet, if there were no opposition voices raised, then the Diet would run very smoothly. The majority opinions would all be pushed through, and the constitutional revision that I mentioned earlier would take place very, very easily. And if something were to occur, then the self-defense forces could be sent and deployed, and eventually Japan could find itself embroiled in war. In other words, I think people in Japan have begun to feel a sense of crisis, that feel a sense of danger, and for for the first time in a very, very long time, the people of Japan have begun to raise their voices. When I look at what has been done by the current administration, I wish that they had not followed the path of basically steamrolling the security legislation through the lower house, but rather lent a year to the voices of the people. But I felt that because the people were beginning to stand up and speak up, I felt that I should join them. And I think this is a very, very good thing that we're seeing happening in Japan right now. As you know, Japan is a nation which has a long culture of basically giving way to the stronger, in other words, to follow silently. And as a result of this tradition and culture in Japan, I think that for many, many years, the true wishes and desires and thoughts of the Japanese people have not been reflected accurately in national policy. Yes, we've had election after election after election, but the results are almost always the same. The LDP wins in enormous numbers. But I think, as I said, this is perhaps the first time that I can remember where just average people have on their own initiative decided to stand up and speak for themselves. They've felt that they can't just leave things up to the Diet. And I think this is a wonderful thing that especially young people are beginning to understand that the principals in this story are the people of Japan. After all, sovereignty lies with the people. And I think this movement that is occurring is an opportunity for Japan to change in a very, very enormous way, that it can truly perhaps become a real democracy where, again, the people are the sovereign, sovereignty lies in the people. I don't know how many more years of life I have left to me, but I thought since the people are working so hard to raise their voices, then I would try to join them and support them and raise my voice as well.
Gentleman here.
Siegfried Knittel, Austrian newspaper, The Standard. You talked about, you said, as a German, I admire your statement in 1995. But I have to ask you, now is not the situation now very different? In 1995, relations with China were much, much better. China was not this kind of aggressive state like today. So was it not easier for you to make this statement, like a difference to Mr. Abe now, if he wants to repeat it? So how should Japan in this different situation, to apologize and to his past, and on the other side, to have a clear position against China? How should Japan behave?
はい、私はオーストリアのものでございますが、もともとドイツ出身でございます。ですので、1995年の村山談話を非常に尊敬するわけでございます。しかしながら、1995年と今の状況というのはちょっと違うんではないかという気がいたします。1995年におきましては、中国と日中関係の方がもっと良好なものだったと思いますし、中国はそんなに拡大、あんまりアグレッシブな国ではなかったかと思うんでございます。で、ありましたので、当時は今に比べますと、あのような談話を出すことがより容易ではなかったかと思うんでございます。つまり今中国の現状、今の日本が置かれている現状を考えますと、もちろん一方では過去において謝罪お詫びをするっていうのもあるかもしれませんが、しかしながら一方では中国とどのようにその対応するべきだと思いますでしょうか。はっきり明確なその立場を出さなきゃいけないかと思うんでございますが、
私はね、94年に総理大臣になったわけですね。当時ね、それは韓国やら中国やらね、ASEANの国を訪問しました。で、感じましたことはね、それはやっぱり韓国はね、36年間の植民地支配というね、歴史があるわけですよ。で、その歴史に対する清算というものをね、やっぱりきちっとしてないと、日本の国は。もっと言えば、あの戦争の後始末をね、きっとつけてないというんで不信感を持っている、まあ、端的に言えばね。それから中国に参りますとね、ちょうどその天安門事件があった直後なんです。で、天安門事件というのは、まあ、ある意味ではその民主改革運動ですからね、 だからこういう運動が伸びていくとね、中国共産党の支配というのはね、やっぱり危なくなるというんで、まあ、当時の実力者である都少平さんがね、もう実力を持ってその学生運動の民主化運動というのを弾圧したわけです、潰したわけです。その後に江沢民という人が国会主席になって出てきた。で、私はその時に日本の総理大臣になったんです。で、江沢民さんと会った時にね、それはもう歴史問題に対する厳しいね、やっぱり質問がいろいろありましたよ。だからね、やっぱりこの歴史問題に対するね、この理解と認識というものをね、やっぱりお互いに共通して理解し合うものがなかったらね、これはやっぱりうまくいかないなというようなことを通説に書いてきましたね。それからその ASEAN の国なんかを回りますとね、これはもう ASEAN の国というのは、さっきも言いましたけども、その戦後独立国になった国でね、今国づくりを一生懸命やってるところですからね。だから日本の国はあの廃墟の中から立ち上がって世界第二の経済大国になったと、日本のおかげで我が国の開発を進んでいると言って大変感謝してるわけです、日本に対して。だけどもね、そう感謝をしてるけども、腹の底の層ではね、やっぱり経済大国になった国は軍事大国になるというのが過去の歴史を教えてるところですから、日本の国は再び過ちを繰り返すんではないかという懸念を持っている。だからこのことはね、やっぱり払拭できない問題があると。日本の国はやっぱりいろんなこと経過があるけどもね、ここではやっぱりそこらの生産をしてきっとそうじゃないんだということをはっきり示して皆さんの理解をいただく必要があると。そうでなければアジアに対する日本の信頼というのは回復できないというふうに思ったもんですからね、まあ、そういうことをやってきたわけです。
As you know, I became Prime Minister in 1994. At the time, I visited South Korea, the Republic of Korea, China, and many of the ASEAN nations. And what I felt was, in visiting these different nations, was that the past was still very much in the hearts of the people there. When I visited South Korea, they had experienced over 30 years of colonial rule, and I felt of Japanese colonial rule, and I thought that the this period of colonial rule and Japan's participation in that period had not really been brought to a close. There had not been an ending chapter to that part of the story, and Japan had not taken care of the after effects of this period of rule. And as a result, there was great mistrust of Japan on the part of South Koreans. When I went to China, this was just a little while after the Tiananmen Square incident. As you know, that was an incident where people were beginning to stand up and trying to ask for more democratic principles to be brought into China, and this of course created great anxieties on the part of the Chinese leaders, and as a result Deng Xiaoping cracked down very hard on the demonstrators. And following him, the new president appeared in China, who was Jiang Zemin, and I met with him in China. And when I had my meeting with him, he gave me many, many very harsh, severe questions. And I realized at that time that unless we have a common understanding and a common awareness of these historical issues, then we would never be able to work together to build a common future. And again, when I visited various ASEAN nations, many of these nations were new or had been were in the process of rebuilding themselves or building themselves anew after the war. Many of them looked with admiration on the example of Japan, which had revived itself after the utter destruction of World War II to become the second largest economy in the world. Many of the people I met with expressed great appreciation for the economic support and cooperation that Japan had extended to these nations. But even as I spoke with these people, I realized that at the bottom of their hearts, there was great anger and a mistrust still lingering about Japan's role in the war. And there was great anxiety about the fact that history has shown that when a country becomes economically strong, it then moves on to become a military power as well. And there was this great nervousness on the part of many of these nations that Japan might also eventually remilitarize. And I realized that unless we in Japan tried to somehow remove all of these doubts and mistrustful feelings, we would not be able to, again, live in harmony with these nations of Asia. And that is why, even though there were many opinions that were against me in Japan, I felt that this was an opportunity to bring things to a close, to answer and resolve these lingering historical questions. That is the only way that Japan could move forward to gain, regain, recover the trust of these Asian nations.
日本を取り巻く客観的な情勢が変わってきてると、いうようなことを前よく言われるんですね。確かにそのあの例えば変わったといえばね、中国は無視できない偉大な国になってきたということが一番大きな変化じゃないですかね。あのアジアの国の中で変わらないかという点は何かって言ったらね、やっぱり朝鮮半島ですね。 朝鮮半島は36度線で北と南と区別されててですね、いまだに終戦状態になるけども戦争状態というのは解消してないんですよ。そのまま取ってきてるわけですからね。これはもう大変不幸なことなんで、しかも北は愛国になって核を持ってですね、非常にこう脅威に感じているというようなことは、まあ当時から一つも変わってないわけですからね。そのまま来てるわけです。 ただ一番変化があったといえば、まあ、アセアンの国なんかもね、やっぱりお互いに協力し合って開発を進めていこうと言うんで変わってきてる。まあ、一番大きな変化は何かって言ったら、やっぱり中国がね、もう無視できない大国になったということが一番大きな変化ですね。だけど私はね、もう中国に何度か行きましたけどね、まあ、尖閣との問題なんかもあって、中国に訪問しましたけどね、これはあの政府代表でもなければ、 役人でもないね、全く民間外交でこう行ったわけですけどね。だから全くそのとらわれずにざっくばらな話をしますけどもね、あの尖閣島という問題はもう以前はね、誰も関心持ってなかったんですよ、関心を。それを68年、1968年に国連の経済委員会というのはね、レポートを出して、そのレポートの中に、 あの尖閣島の海底には依然があると、いうようなことを言いたいから、油が出るというんで関心を持ち出したんです。そして領土権を主張し出したんです。それまではもう全然無視されて問題にならなかった島なんですよ。ただアメリカ軍が沖縄を占領しておりましてね、日本に返還された時に、その沖縄県の中に尖閣島も含まれてたわけです。ですからそのまま日本に返還されてるわけですね。 ですから今実行支配は日本がしてるわけです。そういう状況にあるけれども、領土権についてはね、いずれになるかっていうのはね、これはもう中国は我が国の領土だというしね、日本は我が国の固有の領土だというし、これは再現ありませんよと。ですからまあ一時棚上げにしてですね、みんな口を出し合して、お互い納得できるいい話をすればいいじゃないかというようなことでどうって今まで来てるわけです。 ですから、まあ、この問題はそろそろで解消していかなきゃ意義がないと思いますけどもね、私は中国って言うんですよ。中国はね、あの宣伝の中国っていうのはもうそれこそもう各国からね、もうどんどん侵略をされて思う通りにされてきた国なんですよ。それが今やもう無視できない大きな大国になってきた、ね、北京なんかはもう世界の大都市になってますからね。私は言うんですよ、こういう 建設ができたというのはね、戦争がないからできたんでね、これは平和だからできたんだと。戦争があったらこのことはなりませんよってね。それが分かっとってね、あなた方はね、軍備を拡大してるってこう言うけどもね、そんなことに備えてるんですかって言ったら、いやー、そんなことは全然考えてませんと。中国は覇権を持てませんと、平和を求めていきますと。だから、ああ、それでいきましょうと、僕は話をしてるわけですけどね。 それはね、やっぱり戦争というものがどういう結果になるかというのはね、もう、みんな考えてますからね。もう今、戦争なんかできないんですよ。だけども、それはいざこざっていうのはありますよ。摩擦はありますよ。だけども、それはやっぱり外交努力を通じ、国際機関を通じてですね、いろんな努力をして解決していく以外ないんでですね。まあ、それはあの、あちこちでこの、いろんな事件があったりしますけどもね。 それはまあ、その、しょうがない話だけども、ね。 局部的にこうそういうものはありますけども、国と国との、ね、戦争なんていうのは、ね、もう、ね、ありえないと私は思いますよね。だからまたあっては困るんでね、そういう努力をお互いにしていくことが大事だと。だからもっと国連なんかもね、機能を持ってそういうことができるような姿にね、どんどん変えていく必要があると僕は思いますけどね。
So I understand that the situation in 1995 and 2015 today are very, very different from an objective point of view. We look at the environment surrounding Japan and we see many, many differences. And I think the biggest change in Asia over the last 20 years is that China has now grown to become a great country, one that has a tremendous presence that can no longer be ignored. And what has not, however, changed in Asia is the Korean Peninsula. Unfortunately, they have been divided into two at the 38th parallel. The situation is very strange there. They are engaged in an endless ceasefire. The ending of hostilities has not officially come, has not officially been announced. It's a very unfortunate, sad situation. We know the state of North Korea at present, and we know that they also possess nuclear weapons. So this situation, this very tense and unfortunate situation on the Korean Peninsula has not changed. Another big change, of course, is with the ASEAN nations. We've seen that they have grown economically and have become a viable presence in the world. But in regard, again, to the greatest change, that is the presence of China as a country that, again, cannot be ignored on the world stage. I have visited China many, many times, for example, in regard to the issue regarding the Senkaku Islands. I have never visited as an official or as a government representative, but I'm just simply engaging in what we call a private citizen diplomacy. So as a result, I can speak very honestly from the heart. And I think many of you may know this, but the Senkaku Islands were not even really focused upon by people until 1968, when an economic committee or an organization belonging to the UN issued a report saying that there seemed to be oil fields or oil and gas fields underneath the ocean surrounding the Senkaku Islands. And it was at that moment that China began to declare that it was interested and that it had territorial rights to this area. But as you know, the Senkakus formed part of the Okinawa territory, and the Okinawa islands were under the occupation of the United States forces for many, many years. But after they were returned to Japan, the Senkakus were also returned to Japan, and it is a de facto control of the islands belongs to Japan at present. It's a very, very, you know, sort of deadlock situation where on the one hand, China insists that it has historical rights to the territory, and Japan also declares that it has inherent rights to the territory. And because it was a, such a point of contention, previous leaders of both countries have come together and said that maybe we should put that we should table the issue for some time and wait until a future generation can put their common wisdom together to resolve this issue. And I think that was the best and should be the best approach to take. When you consider what China was like before the war, it was a terrible situation where many countries in the world basically carved up the Chinese continent and for their own interests. And yet, now, as I said earlier, China has been the biggest change in Asia in the post-war years. It has grown to be an enormous and giant, great country, one whose presence cannot be ignored. Beijing is one of the greatest cities in the world. But whenever I speak with my Chinese counterparts, I say to them, look at the wonderful success that you've been able to achieve, the great progress that you've been able to make, and it's because you have not been embroiled in war for decades. And so what are you doing increasing your military might? And my counterparts always say to me, well, we have no hegemonistic intentions. We only seek peace. I think, I don't know how serious they are about these things, but I think many people in the world realize that war, the only conclusion of war is that you have terrible, terrible destruction and suffering. And I think people really understand that we no longer can truly engage in country to country, nation to nation, all out war. Yes, we will continue because human beings do tend to have conflicts. We will have regional or localized tensions. And this is where diplomacy must come into play, and international organizations such as the UN must play a much more active role. It is through this kind of dialogue, I believe, that these kinds of conflicts should be or can be resolved. There will be, as I said earlier, localized incidents, but they must no longer erupt into all-out war. Countries in the future must never, never again engage in all-out war.
Martin?
Martin Kölling with the German financial daily Handelsblatt. You mentioned that Japan is now in an unprecedented situation concerning the security bills. My question is, do you expect that in the end, the Supreme Court will have to decide whether these security bills are constitutional or not? And if that happens, isn't that a highly risky political game that Prime Minister Abe is playing? Isn't that risking a political crisis either way? If if the Supreme Court basically decides that the reinterpretation is constitutional, it would cause a constitutional crisis. And if Supreme Court would side with the skeptics, with the constitutional scholars, then in that case we would have a government crisis. Isn't that a very risky political gamble?
ドイツの記者でございます。先ほど安保法制に関係でございますが、今までかつてなかったような状況が発生しているとおっしゃったわけでございます。憲法学者が今のその法案が大多数が違憲であるというふうに言っているとおっしゃったんでございますが、質問なんでございますが、この件のは最終的には最高裁が決めることになると思いますでしょうか。つまり合憲か、その解釈を変えたということを合憲か違憲かっていうことを決めるのが最高裁になると思いますでしょうか。でさらに質問なんでございますが、違憲といっても合憲としましてもどっちの判断にしましても、安倍総理にとってこれは非常にそのリスキーな状況ではないでしょうか。つまり例えばその解釈が合憲である、解釈変更が合憲であるというふうになりますと、これはその憲法においての危機の状態になる、危機的な状態になるんじゃないでしょうか。そしてまた、違憲であるというような判断を下した場合には、今度政府が危機的な状況に置かれるのではないでしょうか。どっちにしましても政治状況が非常にそのリスクにさらされるのではないでしょうか。
違憲であるか合憲であるかというのはね、その最高裁で判決がされればね、それが一番最高の法規になるわけですね。ですけどもやっぱり最高裁もですね、今までは馴染まないといってね、あんまりそのまともに取り上げてないんですね、まあ、残念ながらね。またその違憲か合憲かなんていうことでね、争った裁判というのは今まであんまりないんですよ、ね、わずかにその砂川事件であったわけだけども、あの砂川事件というのは安保条約に関連するね、やっぱりその裁判であってね、純然たる国内的な問題でもってやったわけじゃありませんから、まあ、だからそこで解釈がやっぱり曖昧になってますからね、それをそのまま適用するということは非常に無理があるというんで、その最高裁というその裁判所でね、この問題に対する決着をつけた例はないんです。ただ、言えることはね、もう大多数の憲法学者がやっぱり違憲だと言ってますしね、それからその内閣の法制局というのがありましてね、その法制局というのは法の番人なんです。だから日本が法律を、政府が法律を作ったりね、なんかする場合には、全部いっぺん法制局にかけてですね、これは合法かどうかということを判定してもらって、そして法案を出すというぐらいに、この内閣の権威を持ったね、一つの機関なんですよ。だから国会議員なんかも質問するときですね、いろいろ疑問があると、法制局長官が答弁するわけです。で、法制局長官が答弁するとですね、もう政府も国会議員も、一応それみんなこう従うというね、格好になってきてるわけですから、非常に権威のあるポストなんです。その権威のあるポストのやってきた OB の皆さんがね、国会に出てきて、そしてやっぱりこの今、安倍政府がやってる集団的自衛権を認めるということについてはね、これは憲法がやっぱり求めないと、憲法に反すると、こう言ってみんな言ってるわけですよ。ね、ですから、そういうことの実態から見てですね、これはやっぱりちょっとおかしいと、やりすぎじゃないかと、こういう国民の批判があることは当然なんでね、そういうところに今の問題点がかかってきているというふうに思いますよね。で、やがて私はこれはやっぱりずっと進行する過程の中ではね、国民の中からね、これは憲法違反じゃないかというね、訴訟が起こる可能性があると思いますよね。だけど判決で出るまでには相当の時間がかかりますからね、その間にどんどんどんどん事態は進展していくと。ということになりますから、やっぱりこの段階で決着をつける必要があるというんで、 国民の皆さんも立ち上がってるんだと私は思います。
So, in regard to whether the Supreme Court will eventually make a decision about whether this is in violation of the Constitution or constitutional, of course, the verdict that they issue, if they do issue a verdict, because they are the highest judicial power in the land, that verdict must be respected. Having said this, however, as you know, the Supreme Court has been in the past fairly reluctant to take a position on these or to become involved in these kinds of constitutional issues. Cases. There have not been many examples. One is the Sunagawa incident, but as you know, the nature of that incident was basically centered around the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty, and the final conclusion, the verdict that was raised, that was given, was also something that was very vague in wording. And to simply take that Sunagawa verdict and say that it fits and is immediately applicable to this current situation, this current security legislation, is, I think, sort of stretching the limits of one's imaginations. So waiting for a Supreme Court decision, I think, is and hoping that the Supreme Court might resolve this issue, I think, is a rather difficult thing to hope for. What I think is more important is the fact that I mentioned, as I mentioned earlier, the majority of constitutional experts have said that this current bill, related bills, are against in violation of the Constitution. And not only that, as you know, there is a bureau within the cabinet called the Cabinet Legislation Bureau, and they have always acted as the sort of guard. The last guardian, last watchman for the law. They are the people of the last resort when it comes to legal questions. And whenever a bill is presented to the Diet for deliberation, it is first checked by the Cabinet Legislation Bureau officials to see if it is in line with the Constitution. And so the head of the Cabinet Legislation Bureau has always had a very strong and respected position within the government. In fact, when there is a legal question about a potential bill or something else, the head of the Cabinet Legislation Bureau is always called to the Diet, and whatever his opinions are, the government and the Diet members always respect that. So it is a position of great power, a position of great respect, and the fact that many former officials who have held this position have come to the Diet and said that the current legislation, which says that exercising of collective self-defense, collective defense is all right, is in violation of the Constitution. That, I think, is something that people must focus on. And that is what people are actually focusing on, and that's why so many people are beginning to think that something is wrong, something is not quite right. And it is only natural, I feel, that the people would be very, very critical of what is happening. I think that in the end, as things proceed, that eventually there will be a lawsuit presented by people saying that the current legislation is against this, the Constitution. However, as you know, court cases take a very, very long time to proceed with in Japan. It will be a very, very long time to wait for a final verdict. And during that time, many, many things will change. So I think what is important is not to wait and not to rely and hope for a good verdict or some kind of verdict by the Supreme Court, but to move and stand up now. And that is, I think, what people are doing.
We've run out of time, I'm afraid, for questions. Sorry about that. My last act today is to offer Mr. Murayama our traditional one-year honorary membership of the club, so we do hope you'll come back and enjoy an evening here. And if you can join me and just thank our speaker today, Mr. Murayama.
時間になってしまいましたので、1年間有効の名誉会員賞を差し上げたいと思います。ぜひまた遊びに来ていただければと思います。本当に素晴らしいお話ありがとうございました。
はい。
はい、
はい、いいの。
Can I ask we all remain in our seats until Mr. Murayama has left, please? Thank you.
ハンタリ文化部です。